as a human, I would certainly like to ensure that humanity is part of the future planet. So one day we can, as I dreamed of as a kid, do all those Star Trek things in all over the universe. When people talk about saving the planet, what they really mean is saving our own asses, not the planet's. It's really hard for humans to affect nature in a positive way. We have a lot of experience of affecting nature in a negative way, whether it's clear cutting, releasing CO2, and so on. But our ability to reforest the Sahara, or you can just go on and on. And as a species, we do not have a very good record yet of countering nature. We are able very much so to exacerbate nature. If there is a natural trend, we can just pile on the avalanche and make it a lot worse. But stopping the avalanche, now, give us 100 years, Star Trek technology becomes possible, maybe then, hopefully. But we're not there yet. And there isn't any evidence that we are at that point where we can. That's not to say we shouldn't try, shouldn't prepare, but we don't have a great record as a species. So my philosophy or my view, or what I advocate and try to advocate, is a better awareness of the planet. And this is something for which many scientists are not any much better than the public, in that most of the planet is not Europe and North America. Most of the planet does not have our lifestyle. Most of the methane emissions do not come from Europe and North America. They come from most of the planet, which is not like here. And many of the assumptions that we make in our daily life on how politically, economically, environmentally, things work and change do not apply outside of the rather limited North American area and European similar type of climate, where most of the science has happened, most of the data is collected. This is changing rapidly because of China and India becoming wealthy enough countries to support science. And so data from areas that actually are represented of much of the planet and much of humanity, which is tropics, is starting to get available. But just for example, I think this year or the last year, several methane measurements are now available for Africa. And there was one NASA campaign 20 years ago for an entire continent with a significant fraction of humanity, a significant fraction of the tropics. There were no methane measurements, not a single one, for hundreds of millions of people for 15 years. And then there were scientists here in the U.S. We've got lots of methane measurements. Yeah, we understand things. Like, well, no, we may understand, what's happening in the U.S. We may understand what's happening in Europe, but for most of the planet, and that's the same thing with the Arctic, is people have trouble understanding how few people live there, how little data is available, and yet how important it is. We're getting an understanding of it's important for many different things. Satellites are invaluable because they do collect data all the time, and models can be useful as a guide, but there's really nobody living there, very few data stations collecting data and so on, And most of the Arctic is Russian, and I am sure there are plenty of military Russian weather stations and sites, but it's not available generally. And most of the methane and oil and gas, the Arctic happens to be in Russian territory. I mean, from Russia's point of view, that's great, but that's just the way Mother Nature happened to put it. Underlying that, which is something, again, people don't realize, 4 of the 10 largest rivers on the planet all dump into the Russian Arctic. And these rivers transport the vast amount of organic material from the Siberian steppe, northern China, into the ocean, which is why the East Siberian Arctic Sea contains half of the Earth's shallow oceans. Everywhere else, the ocean's deep, but there's so much sediment there that's built up over so many years. That's where the oil and gas is. I mean, why is Mississippi River outflow so rich in oil and gas? Because organic material has flown down the Mississippi for a very long time, filled in the northern Gulf of Mexico. Hydrologic processes made oil and gas, which we're now producing, and which also leaks and forms less methane going in the atmosphere. So we have the Mississippi. Brazil has the Amazon. Brazil has vast oil and gas reserves associated with that. You know, Russia has four of them. You know, and so this is, you know, part of the reality of the way the planet is. And this means that many assumptions that we might make based on our understanding in Europe and North America don't apply directly, extrapolate directly to most of the rest of the planet, which is where most of the people live, most economic, you know, activities occur, most of the natural gas and oil reservoirs are, et cetera. You know, this is kind of a reality that I, in my papers and, you know, in interviews, try to communicate that we have to think outside our box of experiences and incorporate reality, which is outside our box.
Got it.